Welcome back to the 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps presented by Blue Flag Racing. It is early in the morning for Europe on the 11th day of January 2015. John Palmer and Phil Diaz with you. And Phil, it has been an interesting race so far. Team Redline started in dominating fashion, but soon...
Yeah, things changed. You know, just small little things here and there. You had, I don't even know where to begin, really. Just little situations here and there, and then you also had Ollie Pakula, who had a quick 360. Pretty dramatic 360. We thought for sure he was going to hit the wall, but he had a very, very nice save. But outside of that, I'd say... mainly been the last 2 hours or so. You had Alexi Yusiakula, who had an incident on the top of a Rouge, lost the car, slammed the wall, got back to the pits, somehow had a fast repair still, and then not even an hour later, Enzo Benito lost the car as well, actually with the help of a lapper. You know, lost the car and has heavy damage now. Well, he hasn't even been able to enter the track again. Currently in the 50th position. So I don't know their status on that, whether he's going to continue to drive or not. Very tough situation for them. They were leading the points, and now, well, who knows what's going to happen.
Absolutely. So just over, or just under, excuse me, 15 hours remaining. Phil, would you take us through the top 10? I've got an interview to wrangle up.
Alright. Just want to note that going to Sim Sports in the pits, but this won't change the top 10. Currently you have NX Racing Red at the top. Been leading for probably the last close to 100 laps or so, followed by going to Sim Sport. For Motorsports in third as well. Nice stable run for them. Glacier Racing in the 4GT. Pretty epic run actually for them in fourth position. And you also have Virgil Racing in fifth. We just interviewed with Anders Dahl. For those who missed that, well, don't worry, the recording will be up soon. NX Racing Blue in sixth. Team Kimura 2 and 7th. Radicals Online 2 and 8th. Birka Racing Team in 9th. Pure Racing Team 2 and 10th. R4R Motorsport in 11th, Pure Racing Team 1 in 12th, Racemore Kraut Racing 13th, Flux Racing Team 14th, and Mad Cow Racing 2 in 15th. Other notables, Team TTL had a strong start, dropped all the way back to close to the 30th position. Now Dylan Sharman has let it charge back up to 23rd, so hopefully they can continue moving forward. If you're following along at the beginning of the race and you're wondering where the GT Rolfs cars are, they're both running in the top five early on. However, both have had incidents where either the rear tires have given out on them, something we've seen in the roof, or you know, just either traffic or, you know, battles going on. I believe both, however, were simply because of the roof. Rear engine and putting a lot of weight on those rear tires, stressing them out, overheating them, as Anders Dahl just pointed out in an interview, and they're, you know, lost their car late in the stint.
So joining us in the commentary box here, from the great state of North Carolina, home to every NASCAR team and other great things in this good old country. So he's on the same time as you, Phil, and me. Corey Davis for car number 97 KRT Motorsports, who are coming into the pit lane. Corey, I understand you've had three stints today. Your next one is early tomorrow morning. How has the race been for you so far?
We're really pleased with how it's gone. We basically started dead last, so we've been able to move up now inside the top 25 and sort of finished our European rotation of drivers, and I had some stints in there as well. And got some of our American guys going to take us through the night, and we'll pick back up in the morning and hopefully still have a car running by then and take it to the finish.
You had any significant issues with, I see you're running 21st, so you're in the top half of the field. Had any issues that have caused you any position, do you think?
We had a couple scares out there. During my first stint, I was coming up through Eau Rouge, and there was a McLaren that was whipping across the track, which is not a sight you want to see. So ended up getting a 4X contact from that, and had a little bit of aero damage. Got that fixed with a toe on the pit stop. I had one other spin going up through Eau Rouge when one of our other drivers was in. So unfortunately, I think that took out one of the top running Porsches. So really hated to see that, but. Since then, we've just been turning along, trying to pick up spots where we can, and just trying to keep a decent pace up.
Do you think you guys can keep moving up throughout the race here? I mean, you've already moved up pretty much over half the field, so you think you can continue to move up?
Yeah, I mean, just during this last stint, even, we've seen several of these top teams that have wrecked, and we know probably a lot of teams are probably done using both of their toes now. Unfortunately, we are too, but as the race goes on, we expect we'll probably see a lot more damaged cars out there. So I think, we can be pretty consistent, but also pretty conservative. Just run, a fast enough, safe enough pace to be able to keep us in it. And I hope we'll be able to pick up some more spots.
Any particular goal that you're aiming for? Is it just a finish? Is it a certain position? Or?
Yeah, this is the first 24-hour race for most of us, so just getting to the finish is the number one goal. Obviously, with double points available here, we definitely want to finish as high as we can. But again, if our little 97 McLaren is still running when that checkered flag comes out, we're all going to be pretty happy.
So you mentioned double points on offer. Just trying to manage my way into your team points standing. Just see where we're at. Car 97 is currently 35th. Not much more than 10 points out of the top 30. Do you think get that good finish with the double points, you'll be perhaps in the top 30 and locked in for COTA?
Yeah, that was our goal. The 97 car finished in the top 20 at Road America, so they had a good run there in that 12-hour race. Unfortunately, didn't do quite as well at Suzuka, so we knew that with that car being, like you said, within 10 points of the locked-in spots, that just having a decent finish here would put us in pretty good shape. So, yeah, we're hoping we can stay, definitely where we are now, if not move up some more spots and get some of those big points on offer.
And with Circuit of the Americas next and closing the season at Bathurst, preferred track at the two, and any specific challenges your team's looking for in those last two races?
I think among the guys on our team, we're looking forward to both of those. So we just did with the Neo Endurance Series, a six-hour race at Circuit of the Americas back in December. That went pretty well. Both cars finished seventh in their classes, so got a little endurance experience around that track now. And of course, Bathurst, I think everyone loves that place, and certainly going to be a challenge going there for 6 hours. But that's another place where I feel like just running a safe, a conservative pace will be enough probably to get us to the end, and hopefully finish pretty well there too.
Now, you're mentioning about the North American and European split you guys have. Is it kind of like an even split? How has it been like making setups and whatnot? I know the McLaren's pretty sensitive in the sense of setup making and whatnot, trying to make everyone comfortable. So how's it really been with that, preparing for each race?
Yeah, we've been lucky. We've got a couple European guys on our team, Carl Modig and Thomas Howland, and they've run together in, I think, the Radical Racing K Series in the McLaren for the past year or so. So these guys are already really experienced with that car. They know what to do with the setup to make it fast, to make it comfortable. Like here, we've got a super fast car in a straight line. We've all been really impressed with it. And yet it's also a car that's pretty stable, pretty easy to control. which is something that we didn't necessarily have, especially back at Suzuka. We all struggled a little bit to get up the pace, but I think with the way that the car is driving now, it's something that everyone on our team, and you know, we don't necessarily have any fast guys that are super fast, super slow. We're all at pretty decent pace, but it's something that we can all control that we're all pretty happy with.
Any big challenges in scheduling for this 24-hour race?
When we started doing the planning, we've had two cars in both of the races so far, and we realized that we probably weren't going to have enough guys to be able to field both cars with a decent-sized lineup for this one. So because the 97 car was a little bit higher up in points, we decided just to focus on that one for this race. So we're able to concentrate all of our efforts. We've got six guys available. So with that, it's pretty nice. You know, you can have plenty of time for people to take a break and also for people to be in the car and around to crew chief or be a backup driver. So in that sense, I'm glad with this being our first 24-hour race that we were able to take it, I guess, a little bit more conservatively as far as our planning goes, so that we weren't trying to push ourselves too much. Certainly, we're learning a lot already from based on stint lengths and fuel strategy and all that that we can use for the next one as well.
Alrighty, any team website or Facebook, Twitter information you'd like to share with the viewing audience?
Sure, yeah, we've been trying to tweet some updates every few hours. It's at twitter.com/KRT_sport. So go check us out there, give us a follow, and again, we're pretty active here in the Masters of Endurance series, also the Neo Endurance series, and a few other places. So we've sent out updates every now and then for all those series.
All right, and one last quick question. Blue Devils or Tar Heels?
Oh, no, I'm an NC State graduate twice, so neither. It's all Wolfpack for me.
Good. Go Wolfpack.
Wasn't expecting that one.
All righty. So, thank you very much, Corey Davis. Good luck to you and the rest of the team, and get some rest if you can.
Yeah, we'll be. Thanks a lot, guys. Enjoy the night.
Good luck.
So, stream is picking up on pictures, and I do believe you just saw an overtake. Radicals Online, Anthony Roselli being overtaken, going into Lacombe by Ben Tusting of Team Chimera, car 54. There, that was battle for the 7th position. Both of those drivers in the later portion of their stint. Coming to last third of that stint. Looks like NX Racing Blue Simon Cattell has done 51 laps in this stint.
Obviously inaccurate.
So that is not exactly correct.
And he's actually in the pits right now. Renz Brokman for Coanda had pit 4 laps ago, and we'll have NX Racing Red pitting here shortly. I believe next lap they'll be in the pits.
Yep, closing in on pit stops again. Virgil Racing, who we were just talking to, 20 laps since their last stop. About a second behind the number 41 car, Glacier Racing. 4GT of Glacier Racing up into 4th. Helped out by the misfortunes of Enzo Benito.
And Team Redline, yeah. And, you know, other teams in general. Hasn't just been Team Redline, but it's just, you know, how much do you push at the beginning? And, you know, I don't really know, as we just see a pass for position here on stream. AB Racing Silver getting overtaken by Racemore Kraut Racing.
Up that in a battle for 19th position. AB Racing Silver, 24 laps since their last pit stop. Racemore Kraut Racing, only 3 laps since their last stop. So those
two.
Yeah,
it's pretty clear who has the fresh tires there. Easy pass for Thomas Backlund. Probably pronounced that all wrong. Apologies if I did. See also Do you see who currently is on stream here? Arihara?
Yes, Arihara.
Long time MOE driver. Very long time. I think this would now be 7 years. Let's just say six, just for the heck of it. I'm pretty sure he's been around for just as long, if not longer.
Give me car number. Oh, same car. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, Arihara. Back in the day when Infinity Esports was X-Fusion.
Yes. And then Infinity Esports formed. Same colors and everything, really. Just
jokingly called Infusion.
Yes. Was gaining on Andy Fuller and KRT Motorsports 2. However, you see Arihara just went off track there. Got a little oversteer on entry. Now it's going to let Glacier Racing by. Lost a lot of time, actually, past sector. Another battle between the 84 of Hellenic Racing and the All-Star Racing Team 3 car, both BMWs. All-Star Racing currently much fresher tires. I believe they're only 4 laps into their stint, whereas Hellenic Racing was over 20. So easy overtaking for All-Star Racing Team 3. Stefan Kennitz.
By the way, just received word from Michael Pascal that he is finally going to tuck off to sleep, like the sissy he is. He says he'll be back around 11:30, so you should hear his voice back soon.
Soon? Think about that time.
11:30? UTC.
Yeah, that's not soon.
It's like 6 or 8 hours.
Yeah.
I was trying to make it feel better.
Yeah. I can do 2 Daytona 500s in that amount of time.
Unless it rains or there's lots of rocks.
That's true. Let's see here. We also have Virgil Racing slowly been gaining on Glacier Racing. Nothing much, though. I believe fresher tires were helping. Oh no, sorry. They're on pretty much the exact same stint plan. So this is just an even match here. Probably traffic and whatnot's been helping. Another team to mention that's been driving through is Phoenix Motorsports. Had an interview with one of their drivers earlier. Currently 1.6 seconds away from top 15. Pretty sure they're really proud of that right now. I believe when we interviewed them, they were down in 29th to 30th. They've been slowly making their way through the field, through pace and some would say other people's bad luck. Want to mention that Marcus Johansson has been closing and on Glacier Racing. because of this, we're actually going to go on board with them and follow along a little bit. See how easy it is to close up to that Ford GT. Possibly make a move here before pit stops. As you can see, Marcus Johansson slowly closing in. Should have a good run here on Kimmel Straight. Hopefully the Mad Cow car up ahead doesn't cause any issues.
So Phil.
Yes.
How about a Ford GTM?
A 4GT update. We're watching the 4GT right now. They're in a nice battle.
Well, guess who's joined us?
Oh.
A member of the 4GT team, Glacier Racing's Alexi Aloma, who tells me he is not tired yet and he is not cracked into an energy drink yet.
That's
Alexi,
good.
Alexi, how are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. It has been so fun race, at least for now.
Done 78 laps so far. 78 incident-free laps, I should hope.
Well, not really. My first stint, it was quite clean, but the second stint, actually the third stint, when Uusi Akkola was behind me, I had to push like hell because I didn't want to let him pass.
I wanted to as a little stay finish thing.
In front of him. Yeah.
And your man in the car, Jani Hagner, getting harassed something fierce by Marcus Johansson of Virgil Racing. Is he handling the pressure in the standard Finnish way?
Yeah, actually, he said before I came here, he said that he didn't know who is the guy behind him, if he should fight with him, because he didn't have the F3 enabled or something. And then I told him it's the Virgil Racing car. And yeah, we were like, should he battle like hell or to let him pass if he gets the position or what to do. But I said him to just don't wreck the car.
Yeah, that's the most important thing, don't crash the car. Jani actually, it was the first time we saw him get in the car today. He went right out in the second lap and decided to pass on and Blanchimont. So he's been a little daring this race. The second pass was around the outside of the source. So hopefully here he's a little bit better. And by better, I mean a little bit less scary.
Yeah, actually, the Jari's team was really scary. He had like 9 car contacts during his stint. Yeah. So we don't have any of those resets anymore.
Do you know about Hagner's history, by the way? And iRacing Master of Endurance, I'm pretty positive, and also just in and Live for Speed in general. Do you know about his history and what he might have drove in Live for Speed?
Yeah, he drove that four wheel drive car.
Yeah, he used to drive the all wheel drive car constantly. And I mean, I don't know why there was an all wheel drive GT car made in the first place, but for some reason his team loved it and they raced it all the time.
Yeah.
Would it be the Danish racing team?
Yes.
Speaking of Hagner, you just got past going into Lake Home, which you saw on stream a little bit ago, by the Virgil Racing car.
So, when do you get back in the car, Alexi?
Well, he only drives one stint after this. Like, he pits in 3 laps or something, and then drives one full stint, so it's like 1 hour and 1 minute or something. And I will do two stints, and then Yari will wake up at around 6 o'clock, so he will do like 2 or 3, I don't know how many stints he will do.
Yes, he said he was something about doing a triple stint in the morning. This is what he said earlier, but he also said that you guys kind of just, you know, make up stuff as you go, as we just saw Virgil Racing into the pits.
Yeah, we don't really prepare, actually. I'm the only one who tries to prepare, like, for the schedules and that kind of stuff. So, yeah. We just try to drive fast, and hopefully we have drivers all the time available.
I heard that Yanni Backman was on reserve. Has he fell asleep, or is he supposedly staying up all race?
No. I don't know if we really use him. He's on the... Actually, he just joined the chat on the stream, but I haven't actually talked to him like in the last 5 hours or something.
Oh, okay.
But we are like good to go to like almost 10 a.m. our time, and Riku went to sleep like 2 hours ago or something. Hopefully he falls asleep also, but yeah, I think we are good to go to him without him, maybe, but yeah, I don't know.
So are you planning to sleep at all, or just maybe 2 minutes?
Actually, I don't know. Maybe because actually Uusi Jaakkola is coming to Turku. We are going to Poland on Monday, so with some other guys. So I should be awake like tomorrow evening. So maybe I will sleep some hours.
I like how you said you were the one that plans, but you're not even you don't even know if you're gonna go to sleep or not.
Yeah.
Yeah, sleep's not important. You can sleep later.
But at least I figured out before the race how long the stint is. So, and if we can go, we can stretch it one lap if we, and that way, beat one time less or something.
Is that what you guys are planning to do currently, or?
Well, we are like doing, like one lap more than. With maximum attack.
Gotcha.
So we gain one stop that way. So we had different plan at the start. We started with less fuel because of reasons. Probably some guys who know how to set up cars can guess why. So I didn't really check that how much make difference.
Just want to say right now that currently you are in third position. How does that feel to currently be at podium level?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Was that something you guys I don't know if you could say expected, but is that something you guys kind of thought was possible at the beginning of the race?
Well, I'd say not really, but in the end we have been like starting from positions like 40 or 50 or something before this race, and now we started from 17. So, and we have always gained, so we have been faster on the long run than many other guys.
Because that's good.
I guess we have like fast, like, or slower. Slowest drivers are faster than like some other teams' slowest drivers. So.
Gotcha. Now, the general consensus is this car is still probably slower than the other three cars. So, what do you think could be done to maybe, you know, help this car to be on a more competitive level?
I don't want it to be more competitive. It's fun right now.
You don't want it to be more competitive?
No, I can always change the car if I want to be more competitive.
I guess that's true. I thought you were going to troll and say you want more straight line speed.
Yeah. Actually, we are running like almost maximum wing.
What?
We are beating them on the straights.
You're running that quick with maximum wing?
Really?
Yeah. Actually, it doesn't gain much speed. But yeah, it's fast on the fast tracks. But if they would add some speed or more, like more downforce or something, it would make it slower on the straight. So I kind of like it. It's a little slower, but we can hold up people with more straight line speed.
Yeah, I was wondering maybe if it was something like a low speed grip or something like that could help you guys out.
Yeah, actually, I noticed when I was behind Enzo and Uusi Jaakkola, they were like getting out of the slow corners much faster. I don't know if it's the gear or grip or something. But yeah, it's really fast on the fast parts. At least the Blanchimont, we are easy flat out. Yeah.
Well, that's good. So I think. Yeah, high speed, okay. That would mean high speed, it's at least pretty competitive.
Yeah, when we go really fast. I don't know why it's that way, because on the medium corners it's much slower.
Nah, I don't know. I'm starting to think it might just be some form of, I don't want to say tire grip, but, you know, something along those lines, something low speed to mid speed, something mechanical, some form of mechanical grip.
Yeah, maybe. But we are pretty good with driver compared to others. So we can actually wait behind some cars and then pass them in the end.
Yeah, that's true.
And save fuel.
Yeah, definitely. That straight line speed can easily save fuel behind people.
Good.
So Alexei, just one other question. Since you are in Finland, mm-hmm. and we are still less than a month removed from the winter solstice, about how much daylight do you get in a day about this weekend?
I would say from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. or 5 p.m. or something.
Oh, that's not that bad. That's not far from here.
No, I think here in Ohio, sun comes up about 7:38 and goes down about 5:30 this time of year. But this time of year, when it's long nights and short days, it's good days to spend inside, turn virtual laps.
Yeah.
Where it's always sunny.
Yeah, actually, if I don't have any schedule, like I don't have to be at school or work or something, I usually sleep during that daytime. And only see
wrong with sleep. So any team websites or anything of that sort you'd like to share with us?
No.
What about Glacier TV? Was that ever supposed to come back? I know supposedly there might have been some word of it.
Yeah, there's been some rumors.
Are those rumors true? Yeah. Or?
Well, those rumors came from the main guy behind the PlayStation TV, so I don't know.
Alright, I was just wondering to see if you guys were gonna come back or not. It'd be cool. I helped out with Glacier for a little bit, so good group of guys.
Yeah.
If me and Phil go to Finland, can we crash at your house?
Maybe. I don't have any furniture, but except my computer stuff and my bed.
We can bring our own furniture.
Can we bring Ernesto along for Chatmania?
Yeah, sure.
Knew that'd be okay.
Yep.
And can you bring Kimi Räikkönen along?
Yeah, we'll call him someday.
Okay, good. Well, good luck to you, and we look forward to hearing some more Ford GT updates throughout the rest of the race.
Yeah, I will be back later.
Good, good. We look forward to speaking with you.
Yes, thanks.
Good luck. So that's Alexei Aloma for Glacier Racing Car number 41, the lone Ford GT in the field, the bravest of the brave. Currently coming out of the pit lane. Sacrificing their podium slot here early on for some pitting shenanigans.
We just saw, see now on stream, it's KRT Motorsports 2, Infinity Esports, directly behind. Radicals Online 2 needed to get by there. They just passed Infinity Esports, which actually put a pretty big gap, and also AB Racing Silver now trying to step in, and they have passed Infinity Esports. You see the Team Khmer 2 car there as well, driven by Mohamed Espatel. That car is actually trying to chase down the Radicals Online 2 roof, currently driven by Anthony Roselli.
Just catching up on the forum thread. People asking, would it be nice if iRacing had another box in the pit stop setting box, giving you the option whether or not to use the Vesto?
Yeah, that would be extremely nice. Or even, a situation to where we could make it to where a fast tow would essentially be like 5 minutes or something like that. Like admins would set, or I guess you would call it a slow tow, where the admins can set a specific time, let's say 5 minutes, and if they use it, it takes 5 minutes to repair their car. Much more fair way of doing it, because then, you know, it adds a penalty to getting a fresh car. Since we don't have, you know, a very strong repair system in iRacing currently. You crash your car, yep, and you're pretty much done.
Unlike MOE's 4-1 Lift Speed, where you pit and it fixed pretty much everything except engine damage.
Yeah, and it fixed it all, you know, rather quickly too, within a minute. You know, well, about a minute. You know, your car is pretty much all fixed.
Yep. Marcus Lenderman offered the comment, for one, it being the Festo checkbox, should replace the bloody, quote, use windshield tear-off checkbox that shouldn't even be there.
It's windshield instant, tear-off?
Yes. He says, it's instant, it's useful, why would you not want to use tear-off?
Well, that is true. Can't disagree with that whatsoever.
Yeah, every time we go, you're all gearing up for a long response, and then all of a sudden you're like, yeah, okay.
Well, I mean, we see, actually, we'll go on board with the number 12 car here, assuming that he's going to have a dirty windshield, and he does not.
Well, yeah.
So AB Racing, you know, Black, or sorry, AB Racing Silver, you disappoint me. You're supposed to have a dirty windshield. They just came out of the pit 7 laps ago, though. Yeah, the windshield gets dirty, and
Car 7's got a fairly nasty looking windscreen.
All right, let's take a peek over at that real fast. That's okay.
That was just the first one. Let's.
That's pretty decent. And you can see little splotches all over the windshield.
Car 133's got a even dirtier one.
You'll see it when the sun hits it, basically, and there's a nice glare and whatnot on the screen. And and the person's right. Oh, sorry about that. Just flip back to AB Racing Silver. They're currently in a battle with KRT Motorsport 2.
And I do have a car smoking in the pit lane. That is car number 112, the GT Ross SST Orange.
Oh, that is a finish to their race, then.
Yep, I'm just winding the clock back to see if I can see what had happened.
Yeah, they're currently sitting in their pit. Actually, both of the GT Ross cars are sitting in the pit waiting for repair to be done.
Oh, he lost. Oh, huge. Just. He got some oversteer going through Pujan, and it. He tried to correct it, and suddenly all the grip came back, and he just speared off into the wall.
Seems to be a common situation. Once again, that's another roof. Having, I guess you could say, stability issues. But as we say that, third, fourth, and fifth position are all roofs. Core Motorsports, Team America Racing, and also Virgil Racing. So some teams have it figured out, some don't. I know the GT Rolls-Royce were really fast at the beginning of the race, and I think that's simply because they ran a low wing and they ran a much more aggressive setup. And the three that you see in third, fourth, and fifth position, they're, you know, they've done three races now. Well, this is their third race in MOE and in this car and long distance races. So I think they have a more conservative setup and understand things a little bit better. And also to note that, you know, a lot of people were saying that, you know, the roof is too fast. And it did show a lot more pace than what it showed previously. However, a lot of the pace that we were seeing had a lot of off tracks and whatnot involved in it. And in the race currently, we are preventing most of those off tracks by using an application. As we see, AB Racing Silver have a huge run on KRT, but that run has pretty much stopped here halfway down the Kimmel Straight. However, they are possibly going to go for the... Nope.
Does have the inside, though. And is stuck to him on the brakes a little bit, and looks like KRT yields the position. Just behind this is Arihara for Infinity Esports Racing.
But just to finish the point, you know, a lot of people thought the roof was a bit too fast, but I think, you know, we saw the GT Rolls guys, and they were really fast. And there was no doubt in my mind they were fast, and they were also able to save a lap of fuel in the process. But the simple fact was that they had to have a really aggressive setup to do that. And all the practice stints we've seen them drive online practice sessions, it was just, they were losing too much time, either having a spin, or they wouldn't even be able to finish a stint because of a crash. And that's just an aggressive setup. And like Anders Dahl pointed out earlier, Virgil Racing had that same issue, but then they made a much more conservative setup. And because of that, they're currently in the fifth position. They seem like they're, you know, pretty in control of their car. We see Arihara now actually having another run on Andy Fuller. KRT Motorsport 2 versus Infinity Esport. Hopefully now Arihara doesn't have to worry about, I would say traffic, but more like a car lapping them. Also want to note that NX Racing Red has made a pit stop. Dave Halink has taken over the car. So I'm guessing now it's Dave and Simon doing the night stint for NX Racing Red. We have Renz Brokman now in the car for Coanda SimSport. Not sure who he is splitting up with the night. I'm sure it'll be him and somebody else.
And as our ever-observant Scotsman, Michael Booth, race admin, points out, lap times are kind of slowing down a little bit. 22s to 23s, 2 minute 22, 23 lap times. Steve keenly observes some of the slower, maybe less experienced drivers are in. Just keeping the car between the white lines during the overnight period.
I think Jorn Jens has just spoken, and he basically just asked, is anybody else going to be sleeping? And yeah, I think that's kind of confirmed that him and Renz Brokman are going to be doing the night stint for Coanda SimSport.
Back to the point about the balancing, Phil. A lot of people do look just at the lap times, and they don't look at the other things. They may just look at the fastest lap, and you can't base balancing off of just one fast lap. Otherwise, all you would do is hot lap.
I don't know. It wasn't just that when looking at this. Now, a lot of people, they brought up a good point, because if you looked, the roof was fast over the course of a stint. But it's just executing that in a race fashion, especially a 24-hour race. You can't run that aggressive of a setup that hard, you know, for 24 hours. It's just not going to happen. So even if they were possibly a half second faster than other cars, it clearly isn't that way in this race. Simply because, you know, you just haven't been able to, you know, execute that aggressive setup.
Yornjens for going to SimSports reports that their current incident count is 48 incidents. 48 incident points anyway. One thing that freaked everyone out in the first round and kind of confused a couple people this round was how iRacing, even in a hosted session with no incident limit, it still says at however many X you currently have out of
17
X.
Yeah, every time I always check when I'm making the hosted session to make sure there's no incident cap, and that, you know, it still is going to say 17 incidents that you're allowed to have, but then next thing you know, you can have 20 out of 17 or whatever.
So it's winding down. Again, don't forget, plenty of ways for you to get in touch with us through the night. Got Twitter. Follow us at Masters of Endu. Use the hashtag IRM. We thank you, Phil, for popping that up on the screen. Also, hashtag MOE on irc.gamesurge.net. IRC for some real-time chat. There's a group in there talking through the stream. There is a count of 30 or so people in there. So you can come join us for a little bit of chat. And also, Masters of Endurance on Facebook. mastersofendurance.net/live is where you can get live timing. And not only do you get live timing, you also get the stream player and IRC chat right next to each other in a nice, friendly format for you all to use. It is...
Yeah, and also, any important links in case you might need that?
And you are watching the 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps, presented by, or supported by, Blue Flag Racing. So, they offered up £150 for this race, so £75 to the winner, £50 to second, and £25 to third place teams, if memory serves.
That is correct.
In a little bit, we'll give you another code for IGP Manager to get yourself a free year of the 2D viewer, which is basically the only way to play IGP Manager.
Sorry about that. We also have a battle for position right now. That is Pure Racing Team 3, and then John Hall and New World SimSports Scarlet. Like, he thought maybe there might have been contact, and he completely backed out of it. So all that hard work of catching up just kind of went on for nothing there. Just want to note that after Yanni Hagner made that, Yanni Hagner made that pit stop in the Glacier Racing car, come out of the pits, and now he's currently in the 7th position. NX Racing Blue just ahead. Yanni Hagner, though, on fresher tires, so maybe he can run them down over the course of a few laps. Currently we see John Hall, who I believe is on fresher tires. Yes, he is. 14 lap fresher tires, trying to chase on Marco Schneiders, which I believe we all know from Live for Speed days, Masters of Endurance.
Yep, I remember Schneiders. I think he was in the in faculty team.
Yes, I believe also Team Evo and stuff like that.
Yeah, I think
also
Evo.
I was going to say Iberica Racing teams in the pits. But anyway, continue. There's actually a lot of Germans in this field. We just haven't really been able to speak to any of them. Most of them focused on the races. And we see John Hall here once again. Actually has a really good run out of the final corner. But I don't think, it doesn't look like he's going to have a run here. Seems like that McLaren has a really high wing. That or they have aero damage. See Arihara here letting all these guys by. This is actually for position. I think Arihara is being a little bit too nice. I don't even know how that's possible, but it is. John Hall now has a huge run. Arihara is just going to let him by. Interesting strategy. I guess he doesn't want anything to do with them. Just wants to do his stint, stay. Even if he loses a couple positions, he can get them back later on.
Oh, and Last Lap Motorsports has lost their engine, heading towards Fangio's chicane out of Pujon. Maybe seem to have had some sort of incident. They lost it coming through Pujon and hit the Armco to the inside of the track and just completely wrecked the front end of that car.
Yeah, it looks, judging by the skid marks, very similar to AB Racing Black that we saw earlier. If I remember correctly. Once again, another roof. Probably struggling with rear tires. Unfortunately for them, I believe, well, they're most likely out of fast tows, and therefore the race may be over with.
Yeah, there's no one sitting in the car right now.
Yeah, if that engine would poof, then it's definitely over for them. Oh, as we just see a spin now. Is it Andy Fuller? Yes, it is. We're actually watching to see if John Hall could catch him. Doesn't look like it. We're actually going to... Let's go and check out on a replay here. See what happened.
They're coming out of Curve Fall Frere now on the way... Blanchimont.
I think it'll be one of those situations where what we've seen from the McLaren today, the high speed oversteer going into the corner.
Goes in fine, runs wide.
Curb? Oh, wait, whoa, yeah, pure racing
it was,
team.
Oh, yeah, got a little bit of a wall there. Or maybe a little help too.
Yeah, had a little piece of the wall. I don't think it's going to be too bad. That wall's sort of soft if you clip it like that. Hopefully they're okay. See shortly with their lap times if the car is okay or not. Currently led by a couple cars just to be on his own and see what the car can do.
Andy Gooderson in the spectator chat saying that the body shops will be busy on Sunday afternoon, Monday after the race.
No doubt about that. As I believe I mentioned earlier that Mohamed Espatel had come out of the pits and had fresh tires in comparison. Oh wait, no. I'm sorry about that. No. I only have one lap fresh tires in Miracles Online too. So he's just been slowly running them down. Team Iberica Racing have pit a few laps ago, I believe I mentioned that. They fell from 4th place to 9th place. That whole, anything from P3 back to, I would say, P9, they're all relatively close together when it comes to pit stops and whatnot. They all shuffle around, which is good to see. Just see Vortex Sim Racing 2 getting out of the way for Team Camaro.
Two.
Lots of twos going on here, actually. This radical's on mine, too, just ahead. Right on board here with Patel. See how his McLaren's treating him. Like a little bit of understeer there on entry. I couldn't tell if that was understeer or maybe oversteer, and he just couldn't turn the car in case it would spin out or something. We'll just say sensitive on entry. Looks like Muhammad's actually dropped back quite a bit this lap. Yeah, roughly almost a second. Hopefully his teammates didn't tell him that he's on stream. If so, maybe he's getting nervous. Probably doubt it though, very, very good driver. I believe he actually raced in Pro Series, maybe even made it to DWC. Just to report on the top two positions. Currently 1 minute 20 seconds between NX Racing Red and Coan to SimSport. If anyone has been watching since, well, almost from the very beginning, less than 2 hours in, when Coan to SimSport were struck with a lapped car joining the track, well, let's just say in an improper fashion, and collected Coan to SimSport. They've actually rallied all the way back to the second position, which is pretty amazing. Renz Brokman currently in the car. To be only a minute and 20 seconds back is another achievement in itself. Actually gonna go from one McLaren to another. Now on board with John Hall once again. Many probably know him now from the race prep guides he makes for all the GT3 cars. Also all the setups that he gives out so graciously. Currently I've been catching AB Racing Silver, trying to crack the top 20 here. Here a slight little lift there, a little bit of understeer and also maybe a little bit of oversteer as well. McLaren seems to really struggle on those high speed corners. Seems like that in the roof has a little instability there. All the Ford GT and BMW seem to more have the instability on low speed. Alexi Alom was saying earlier that they're actually running pretty much flat out in Blanchimont. He also said that they're running almost full wing, so maybe that could be one of the reasons for it.
And the AB Racing Silver car gets a bit of a twitch on in Bruxelles. So head out down the hill towards Pouhon. John Hall for NWSS Scarlet moves to the inside on Pouhon, parks it on the inside and gets around. And Iberica Racing Team following through while landing. Hey.
I was going to say, Iberica Racing Team, I think, two laps ahead of this panel, maybe only one. Yeah, and he's making his way around them now. So now John Hall has helped that New World SimSport Scarlet Team go all the way up to the 20th position, breaking the top 20.
Yep, as Jesus Cecilia works his way around for Blanchimont.
Actually, we're having a little McLaren fest here, because we're now going to look at the Mad Cow Racing, who's currently chasing down Vortex Sim Racing. It's two McLarens here. Craig Hunter doing a pretty good job. Last lap 19.7. Quite fresher tires, actually 15 lap fresher tires, so this is going to play a big role into what happens here. Just want to note also that the difference between pit stop numbers of NX Racing Red and Coanda SimSports has fallen all the way down to 5 laps. So they're actually pretty close right now to getting back on schedule with NX Racing Red.
It's a battle for 13th position we're watching. Mad Cow Racing number 2, Craig Hunter in 14th. Trying to chase down 13th place Christian Thielozuch for Vortex Sim Racing.
Actually, let's do another onboard. You'll probably see a lot of onboards through the night. Just a heads up for anybody who's still watching, which hopefully there's still quite a few of you. Mainly because, well, we can't simulate night, as in you won't see the skies get dark or anything like that. However, you can simulate how they behave at night, which is lots of onboards and following cars that way. Currently on board the number 20 car. Looking back at Craig Hunter from Mad Cow Racing 2. Solid run for both teams, actually. Vortex Sim Racing was running up front early on, dropped all the way back to, I don't even know, I'd say probably 30th position or so, and now has charged all the way back up to the top 15. I want to say a charge mainly led by Joel Guess, who drove the first 3 hours of the race. Should see Coanda SimSport into the pits this lap. Currently 1 minute 24 seconds out of the lead. We'll be making their pit stop 5 laps earlier than NX Racing Red, so they'll make up roughly, let's say, 10 seconds on NX Racing Red in the process, and then slowly lose it over the stint if, you know, everything runs its course. We also have Yanni Hagner for Glacier Racing slowly catching NX Racing Blue. They have 9 lap fresher tires. Have it all the way down to 0.8 seconds. May flip to them soon, depending upon what happens here in this battle. Yeah, let's flip to that Glacier Racing car. Haven't looked at them since Alexi Aloma was interviewed earlier.
Heading down Kemmel Straight into Les Combes.
Yanni Hagner just a little bit faster, but now he has the draft, so that draft coupled with that 4GT straight line speed is huge.
NX Racing Blue 22 laps since last up, Glacier Racing 13.
About a 9 lap separation. That's almost roughly a second. I'd say it's about 8/10 of a second. Those 8 to 9 laps. I don't think many people understand how much I enjoy watching this 4GT actually battle for potentially a top 5 position. it's a great feeling after seeing how bad it was first round, and Glacier Racing still picking it just for the fun of it, just because it's so slow. They saw it as just basically a dog turd, to be honest with you. So they thought, hey, why not? We'll drive it. Now it's a polished dog turd. It's moving a little bit quicker.
Well, it's just like the FXR was back in the LFS Masters of Endurance days.
Yeah, Yanni Hagner feels just like he's at home now.
Yeah, he does.
It's just not all-wheel drive. Just want to note that Coanda SimSport did pit this lap. Currently in the pits now. And no, they have not finished the pit stop yet.
It is nice, though, having the underdog vehicle performing well. And as with the FXR back in MOE, if you knew how to drive it and you knew how to work it,
it was fast, yeah.
It was, yeah. So while we keep an eye on this battle for place, we've got an Aussie in with us, Dylan Sharman for Team TTL. Dylan, how is it in the land down under?
It's not too bad today. The sun's shining, and had a nice little nap, so we're raring to go for today.
And what time is it for you?
I reckon it's afternoon. It's about, it's 12:45 in the afternoon. So
you reckon it's about a quarter to one.
He probably doesn't have a clock near him, besides his
computer. Yeah,
I just tabbed out. Yeah, it's 12:45, so it's lunchtime. Might get some Hungry Jacks or something. We're the champions.
So how was your sleep after having two Red Bull?
It was tough. Took me a little while to get to sleep, but it wasn't too bad. I had about 2 hours, 2.5 hours sleep, and then came back and found out that one of our drivers had a few incidents while I was asleep, and both our quick toes are gone now. So that's not ideal, but you know, we'll soldier on for the next 14 hours and see how we go.
Oh, big switchback angling battle that you just saw there.
Did you see that from that camera angle? Both cars sideways trying to get on the throttle there. Sorry about interrupting you on that. Yeah, actually, I saw you guys dropped way back, and I couldn't understand what was going on. I kept wondering, why is TTL way back there? But now you guys have moved back up to the 22nd position. Vale Rich is currently at the car. In the car.
Yeah, Vale's doing a good job, but he also... I mean, we got stung as well by a lap car that spun at the final chicane, and he just hit our right rear, which gave us steering damage, and... You know, because we were already like 3-4 laps down, we decided to take the extra minute and a half to get it fully repaired, and it's got some chronic understeer, but the lap times aren't too bad, so they're manageable, that's for sure.
So race has been kind of quiet for you guys in the ride, or anything interesting happened while you were off that you were briefed about?
No, not too many interesting things. I did come back to see if some of the leaders were out of the race, which was a bit of a surprise.
Oh, sorry about that. There was contact between Glacier and NX Racing. A little blocking going on because they were overtaking a lapper. And then Yanni Hagner has been very impatient. Here we go. Go for a dive up the inside. Nope. Yeah. Actually, I want to ask you a question, Dylan, about the McLaren. How is it in the high speed, especially later in the run? Does it get, it has to get some form of, oversteer? Because we've seen Ollie Pakola spin, we've seen Alexei Yussi Jaakkola spin, and Rouge. So Enzo have an incident, which I believe was more with a lapper, but also his pole lap even had oversteer in Blanchimont. Is it just something to do with the McLaren, or is it maybe the team redline setup?
No, it's definitely to do with the McLaren. I'll let you guys just actually commentate this. It's a pretty interesting battle with this 4GT, but...
Yes.
It's something to do with the McLaren. The car has so much understeer that to make it turn good, you've got to use a lot more throttle, and that lights the rears up. So you've just got the nightmare of oversteer or understeer. You can't really... We'll hit each other there, but you can't really... can't really do much about it. Like, you get rid of the understeer, then you're gonna have too much oversteer, and it's a nightmare. I don't know what iRacing's sort of done with the car, but they've sort of gone backwards with it in my mind this season. So, but it's still fun to drive. I find it the best GT3 car out there, and yeah, it's good fun.
Yeah, it's really fast over a course of a lap, maybe even up to 5 laps, but then it seems like it really just falls on its face after that, as we see Yanni Hagner finally able to get around an X Racing Blue here, Robin Fiskops. So now we can focus on this nice orange and black McLaren.
Currently running in 22nd position.
But yeah, the McLaren definitely is a fun car to drive, albeit it's got a few minor issues, which hopefully they will eventually fix. But I'll tell you what though, that Ford GT3 is extremely quick around here.
Yeah, we're wondering why it was so quick in a straight line. So then we heard that Alexi Aloma mentioned that they're actually using almost max rear wing.
Yeah, we are. Yeah, it was because when I did my opening stint, and they just came up behind me, and they were, I don't even know where they came from, but they could hold onto their tyres, pretty well over the course of a stint. They wouldn't drop off too much, but they were insanely quick and just let them go. But they're having a good run so far.
Yep, highest up I believe is the third position, currently running fifth for them. So, we're not even halfway yet. believe it or not. Where do you think you guys can get back up to? Currently in 22nd.
I guess it's tough. Like, it's just so long to go. Like, we've what, done 11, almost 11 hours, and it feels like it's been forever. So, but we're hoping probably to get inside the top 15. Who knows, possibly in the top 10. There's still more than half a race to go, which is the crazy part. So, yeah, I've still got about 5 hours left of running to do for the rest of the race. So, it should be good fun.
That sure. Sounds like a late charge is in store then.
Yeah, definitely. We'll sort of just trundle around and sort of see where we come, where we get up to, and within like the last 2 hours, we'll try and make a charge if there's a chance for us to sort of make some positions. Otherwise, we might just, you know, relax a bit and just try not to damage the car or anything like that.
Do want to mention real quick that Last Lap Motorsports are back on track turning laps after that massive shunt at Puan.
Also, NX Racing Blue have made their pit stop.
So, when are you going to be in the car next, Dylan?
I'm going to jump back in the next stint. I was meant to do the current stint that Vale is doing now, but when I woke up and I saw that, you know, we'd lost both of our fast toes and Vale got hit, I sort of just went and did the next stint just to make sure and see how the car actually was, because it did have a bit of damage, but it's not too bad now. So, yeah, I'll jump back in the next stint, and then I think I'm going to have a break until about 6 p.m., 7 p.m. local time where I am in South Australia, so that's about 4 or 5 hours break. So yeah, just do another stint, see where we can get up to, and go from there, I guess.
I guess someone's heard you speaking on stream in the IRC and offered the comment, OMG, it's Danny Rick. I guess thinking your voice sounds an awful lot like current Australian national F1 hero Daniel Ricciardo.
Oh, yeah, good old Danny Ricciardo. Yeah, how good's he doing in F1? That's pretty remarkable for his first year.
He made Simfin.
Yeah, I think there was a lot of people very happy that he made Vettel cry a little bit, but it should be an interesting season coming up for the Formula 1, that's for sure.
You ever go to the GP in Melbourne?
Unfortunately not. The GP's in Melbourne. I've sort of always wanted to go, but obviously with work and that, I sort of haven't had the chance, but who knows, in 2017 they're bringing in some new updates or something to the Formula 1 car, which might make it, you know, get the sound back, so we'll see what happens there. But yeah, I eventually do want to go, because it's sort of like I'm definitely on the bucket list of things to do, is go to an F1 race.
I'm assuming you have been to the Bathurst 1000 or the Bathurst 12 Hour.
Yeah, I've been to the Bathurst 12 Hour. I've never been to the 1000 though. I'm more of a GT3 sort of guy, and with the 1000 I sort of just think that, you know, being at home, like, oh, the atmosphere would be awesome there, definitely, but obviously I'd rather watch it on TV and then I can actually sort of see what is actually happening, where when you're at the racetrack, you're a bit complacent to what's going on. You can only really see what you actually see, unless you're like a big screen in front of you or something like that, so.
Yeah, fully understandable, actually. It's quite funny. Normally I go to the Roar Before the 24 every year, and this year I can't.
You scheduled.
I'm sitting here. Well, Roar Before the 24 moved back a week. It's not my fault.
As I said, they scheduled.
Yeah. And, so yeah, that kind of screwed it up. So I might go to the Rolex 24 now, even though normally you'd think I'd go there. However, I don't actually normally enjoy going there. I'd almost rather watch it on TV or on streams and have all the live timing and stuff open, just because I want to follow the race more. I know the atmosphere and everything would be cool to go there, but I think more of the atmosphere, or I'd say the atmosphere doesn't really overcome the sense of necessarily, you know, covering the race and watching the entire race.
Yeah, definitely.
However, if you want to go to France, we might be going to Le Mans this year, so it's a far trip for me and a lot of money out of my pocket. However, that's going to be a different one. Maybe I need to talk to Jonathan Butel about that.
Yeah, I think Le Mans is something that I sort of want to go to as well. There's a few tracks and a few events that sort of are definitely on the list to do. The Le Mans 24 hour, the Spa 24 hour, and the Nürburgring 24 hour, sort of the international ones, are definitely
the
something
international
that I do want to go to. Yeah, well, they're the three, I guess the three big ones. You know, in Europe and that sort of would be amazing to go see and be a part of, so.
Also, I know this is a complete change now, back to the actual race. How's it been with slowdowns? I know you mentioned that you guys are going to try to take it a little bit easy around Eau Rouge and whatnot to try to not get them. Has that actually worked, or do you still get them every now and then?
We're still getting them every now and then. It's tough because you sort of, you want to really push, and you want to like try and find, you find it easy to drive when you're sort of near the limit. And when you sort of take a step back, you sort of make a few mistakes here and there. And it's just trying to change the line, because if you get it wrong into Eau Rouge, you're bound to go over that curve. And I think I've done it about three times in the stint I did before. That wasn't too bad, but yeah, it's just so tough. Like, you make one little mistake for Eau Rouge, and well, I just call that over team speak. Yep, slow down, and there it is, another slow down. So, but we've got it down pat now, pretty much. When we do get the slow down, how to clear it pretty easy, but it's a bit of a pain, but it's not much we can really do about it, I guess. Just a latency issue, I think, so. And I believe the other Australian teams have that issue as well. Just saw a couple of posts on Facebook and that from Mad Cow Racing. They were saying some of the same issues as well, so.
Actually asking because we just noticed that they got one, so. Currently you see Arihara on stream. Sorry about that, we see Arihara on stream for Infinity Esports. Just had a spin and look home. Saw the tail end of that on stream. Also missed Pure Racing Team 1 getting around R4R Motorsport. But yeah, Mad Cow Racing with, well, their car has been very noticeable on stream.
Yeah, those orangey red rims and the cow design.
Yeah, they're definitely
very...
Yeah, they are. They're all the way up to 13th position. At least their second car is. Their first car is pretty heavily damaged and way back in the field, but it's cool to see one of their cars doing really well.
Yeah, definitely. And it's interesting to sort of see that they're only running three drivers, and just looking at how many laps Craig Spark did, he would have been his host. They're triple stinting, I think, so that'd be pretty tough on them.
Yeah.
There'll be some tired people going to work tomorrow, I think, in Australia.
Yeah, it's very unfortunate for you guys. This race ends at like 3 a.m. your time, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's not too bad. I guess from my perspective, it's not too bad, because I've got most of the next week off anyway, because I've got... I play tennis down in Adelaide, so... I've taken a couple of days off work, so that's not too bad for me, but yeah, if these guys didn't take any time off, then they'll have fun with a couple of hours sleep and go on to work.
Yeah, that's, I'll go ahead and apologize for that. It's just, it's so hard to schedule everything for everyone in the world, really.
Yeah, there's not much you can do about it, I guess. Like, in the end, you sort of got to try and do the best of what you can, so yeah, you might make it perfect for someone else, like maybe the Euros. They might be a little bit dodgy for us, but in the end, you know, we want to be a part of this series, so we're not really too worried about sort of what time we're going to get up, that sort of stuff, because it's 24 hours, so it's not too bad. Someone will just cop the night stint, I guess.
Yeah, thank you for that dedication, by the way.
Nah, so we've got the best drivers in. We've got the best drivers in the GT3 series here, so might as well race against the best, that's for sure.
Yeah, that's a good point. Isn't there also GT3 series SEK, I believe. I think I've seen you racing in it.
Yeah, that runs on a Sunday night, and we won that last season, and we're sort of taking a step back this season, just running every now and then, but yeah, that's actually been taken off pretty well. There's a few better teams have joined this coming season. But yeah, they're getting about 45 cars on their grid, so yeah, the GT3 series is sort of starting to take off with this team racing, that's for sure.
Just want to mention what you're looking at on stream. The bouncy Marlboro car is Marlboro Motorsports, having some lag issues, but they're in a battle with the blue and black car of Atlantic Racing Team. Both on 25 laps since their last pit stop. Atlantic has closed in the gap. And they may pit this lap or next lap. And it might, if they pit at the same time, it could be a race in pit lane. Service pending, obviously.
Yeah, lots of lag there actually from the Marlboro car. Hopefully Virgil Racing's a little careful here.
Yep, Virgil Racing roughed just behind, hitting up Gerv Paul Frere.
Oh, have you guys had any netcode issues with being next to cars or anything like that? Coming from Australia, normally that would be the normal thing we'd see.
Yeah, actually, it's actually been pretty good. I don't think I've actually made any netcode with anyone, so... it's been good so far. We haven't really, and the battling has been good, like, you know, everyone's leaving the room. You know, just people knowing that we're from Australia, so they give us a little bit more room. Just because of the netcodes, I guess it's well known now, but yeah, we haven't netcoded anyone. There's been no real issues with that, which has been pretty good.
Alright, that's good to hear.
So where would you like to end up come 24 hours after start? Any change in that since we last spoke?
Well, we're actually coming along not too bad now. We're up, back up to 21st. I think Vale's about halfway through his stint at the moment, so if we can somehow, you know, get anywhere near 10th to 15th, I think, considering where we were at, that'd be a pretty good finish for us right now. But yeah, who knows, it'd probably change in the next couple of hours, that's for sure.
Alrighty, Mr. Dylan Sherman. Good luck. Be safe up there with your next stint. And don't be a stranger.
Yeah, we'll do. I might catch
an update
a little later on.
Excellent, thank you.
Was Dylan Sherman from Team TTL. See, Vale Rich is now up to the 21st position for them. Was just talking about the Glacier Racing car, and they're just ahead.
So that close battle between Hellenic and Marlboro Motorsport for P29. Looks like it'll take to pit lane, I would guess, this lap, since they're both 26 laps since last pit stop, heading up towards Blanchimont now, as we're looking at Mad Cow Racing going through the chicane.
Yeah, sorry about that. Was just giving some Australians some love there. Go over here now to... go back to the Hamek Marlboro, who are both pitting. And no, we're not going to sit here and watch 90 seconds of them racing through the pits. Sorry. We can, however, switch to KRT Motorsport 2, who's trying to run down... I almost have every team memorized, and then there's a new team, All-Star Racing Team 3. We pop in. Now, Coenda SimSport just behind the KRT Motorsport 2 car here. This is one of those situations. You have a car that's much faster than you, currently in the second position, and it's like, should I just let him by and then, you know, wait? And when Coenda then passes the car ahead of me, then, you know, push then. I think this is actually what he's doing now. Clearly he's listening to me.
Or you're just psychic.
That's it. just want to mention that NX Racing Red and Koenig Simsport, I believe, have made pit stops since we last spoke about them. NX Racing Red, Jake Sturgis currently driving that car. Ren's broken and driving for Koenig Simsport.
Yep, 5 laps since last stop for NX Red, 8 for Coanda.
Yeah, they've already put that gap to 3 laps since they pit. Ooh, and we see KRT going way off there. Gotta be easy with that now. We're watching you closely. Now he's starting to make a little bit of mistakes here. So he gained on All-Star Racing Team 3 for a little bit. Now he's starting to make mistakes. I believe Brian Carey's actually on the west coast of the U.S., so it's pretty early for him. Even if it's on the east coast, it's still early.
Yep. Coming up on towards 10 p.m. here on the east coast of the USA.
Actually, now that he's dropped back, I think it's a good time to show the 2 leaders. NX Racing Red, Jake Sturgis. Pretty quiet all race, actually. Just kind of minding their own business. Had early on, they were just drafting with Koenig Simsport, and then I believe they overtook Team Redline a few hours in. And after that, it's been pretty smooth sailing. Look back at Koenig Simsport here. You can see just how far they are behind. We had Jake Sturgis just past the start finish line. We switched back and Koenig Simsport about halfway through the lap. Pretty accurate, actually, they're about 1:13 behind. Currently following lap traffic. I believe that's the All Star Racing team just in front, but their third car actually.
Daniel Hick of All Star Racing 3 being lapped again by Coanda.
Pretty good move there on the inside of Blanchemont. Also want to note that Core Motorsports has made a pit stop from the third position, and in the process of doing that, everyone's favorite Ford GT3 Glacier Racing have made their way all the way up to the third position once again. Another battle that's currently, but it's just shaping up now. Radical's online too, and Team Kimura too. Both teams have been pretty quiet as well this race. We've seen some battles. Team Kimura 2's been in some battles. Radical's online too. Also been in some battles, most notably with Glacier Racing earlier in the race. Also, just a little bit further back, it's happening right now. The 4-car R4R Motorsports just passed Phoenix Racing. That was for the 14th position. Saw that happening on my timing screen, didn't see it in iRacing. Team Kimura should have a run here, however, Radical's online too. Looks like they're gonna have the draft, so looks like Mohamed Espetel is going to have to wait another lap. Possibly. Yes.
And maybe he was waiting just because of that lapped car just ahead.
We're actually going to go on board with him so we can hear his throttle and whatnot. This actually might be a decent time to make a move. Nope. Now, actually, I think I remember when we were following them before, at least the Radicals on line 2 car, for sure, there was actually a spin just in front of them, and turns 12 and 13, I already forgot the name. The right left after Pujon. We saw an incident with a car spinning. Yes.
Radicals kind of mucked around a bit through the chicane.
Yeah. That's the next corner.
Crax Racing BMW Z4, Thomas Pendergrass at the helm.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they're holding these two cars up massively. Hasn't really given an easy way past either. And Mohamed wisely backs off there. Actually, I think he backed off so much he was expecting a mistake. Hopefully he doesn't hold up too much here.
Crax Racing Team parking on the apex of the left-hand part of the chicane, but finally being cleared.
Now let's see if Team Camaro 2 car can finally get past Radicals. Actually, the closest battle on the racetrack, so we're just going to keep with this for a couple minutes. Here we go. This is a huge run. This won't last long at all.
Radical's covering the inside, if that's even going to matter. That's not.
No, it's not going to matter at all. He's already around. Surprised actually the Radical's car stayed down there for so long. Could have just lifted off and moved up the track, but maybe that's my more patient side speaking.
Yeah, that battle that we saw interrupted by the pit stops between Hellenic and Marlboro Motorsports, it pretty much stayed that same gap. It's about 1.5 seconds. Previous lap down to 0.685 last time, and drifted back off as Hellenic George Almaraz, another familiar name. Hellenic using the I think they used to be known as the Greek Virtual Racing Team, another team that was kind of keen on the FXR in the Live for Speed MOE days.
Well, they raced under Hellenic Racing as well. I remember that for sure. I remember their red and blue XRR from Live for Speed. Actually, it looks like he's starting to lose a little bit of connection here.
Yep, having some issues. There is Jarvicki from Marlboro Motorsports, car number 77. Another Finnish driver on 84 laps of the race so far.
Just an interesting note that was during Alexei Loma's interview, I remember him saying that they were going a lap further. And he wasn't actually kidding. They're going 27 laps with that car. And Jani Hagner is actually in the pits right now. So they could actually cut a pit stop out, which would be huge for them later on in the race. Alexi Alama getting back in the car. Looks like the Marlboro Motorsport car here might be pulling away from Honic Racing.
Currently looks like it. Just scrolling through the positions list. Less than 3/4 of a second in it between CTC Racing 2 car 119 and 8 or 80, car 80. Heading down towards Pujon. 8 or 80 Arthur Lamont at the wheel of that. Sam Doby at the wheel of the CTC Racing number 2 car. This is a scrap for 35th position. Later 80 on 2 laps since their last pit stop. CTC Racing 2, 6 laps since their last stop, so a 4 lap difference. Also hearing that Last Lap Motorsports seem to have retired from the race. Tried the repairs, but still about, I think it was 10 seconds off the pace reported.
Yeah, that car was pretty crippled after that crash.
So Phil, you know this IGP manager thing?
Yes I do.
You know how it's all cool like that, especially if you get a group of your friends together?
Yeah, it's quite fun actually to get everyone together and just have a little fun hour and a half maybe, once a week or multiple times a week.
Well, you know, let's give away another code, shall we, for a free year's worth of 2D viewers. What if you're like Michael Booth, Phil? If you don't have any friends like Boothy has, can he still play with anyone else?
If you don't have any friends, which Boothy just asked, you can still play. There are plenty of leagues to join, you know, ones that are really competitive and ones for people who are just joining in. And I believe iRacing used to have one for the longest time. I don't know if they still do or not. Some of the staff play it and whatnot. So, you know, just jump on there, have a good time. There's a free account you can go and race with and manage your team with and everything. And the only thing, you know, you're really missing out on is being able to control everything in the middle of the race. And with this code that you're about to supply everybody, you're going to be able to, control everything in the middle of the race. So you're going to be able to manage your tires and your fuel properly and change whatever you want on the fly.
Now remember, igpmanager.com/special. You can have a new account, a long time existing account, whatever. First one to use this code gets to use it. You'll enter it as your coupon code for the free year of 2D Viewer, a £20 value. Next code is on your screens, pens and papers at the ready, boys. 9B2E8. Enter that as your coupon code at igpmanager.com/special. Once again, the code is 9B2E8. Boys and girls, on your marks, get set, go to way. We would like to thank IGB Manager for being a sponsor of the series, Jack Basford, a longtime friend of the Masters of Endurance series. We won't mention the website he referred to in a late-night interview years ago in the MLE 24-hour race.
Yeah, the, yes. That's all I'll say.
It is late night. It's past watershed, so we can get away with it, but we're not.
Not one bit. Not one bit whatsoever.
Oh, let's run through our other sponsors, Phil. Let's do Blue Flag Racing, title sponsor of this race. Facebook.com/Blue Flag Racing. We talked to a gentleman from there earlier. Might have another one or two throughout the last 13 plus hours of this race. Let's go with, we already did IGP through the giveaway. Season ending prizes from GrandPrix247.com. You're interested in what's going on in F1 off-season testing and other silly season matters? Check that out. And also, big one giving away some big things at the end of the season. Derek Spear, Derek Spear Designs. DerekSpearDesigns.com. They'll be giving away a total of 6 track bosses, which is a good button box for you to use in this sim thing.
This sim thing?
There's, well, you know what I meant.
There's a lot of buttons, a lot of knobs.
Yep.
Very useful to...
Switches.
Yep, very useful.
To manage your own car, your team.
Yep.
Or if you're a race director, you can use it to assign, auto-assign penalties to your normal victims.
That's true, actually.
As Aider 80 Arthur Hermont has a run on the right-hand side of the Kimmel Straight on the CTC Racing 2 car of Sam Doby, and he clears on the way to Lecombe.
Yeah, that was just real simple. I believe CTC Racing 2 car. They're just kind of cruising right now, minding their own business.
Since we're watching GTRS Azura, Samuel Augsburger.
Yeah, they just passed Ariaro in the Infinity Esports car. Ari once again just being nice and letting almost everyone by. Seven car pure racing team just exiting the pits now. And then about 3 seconds behind R4 Motorsport, you see them at the front of the screen here. Just want to note also that the number 10 car of Iberica Racing Team has been given another drive-through for off tracks.
I just want to mention, I think as we just saw through there, through the pins from it together. There's a little smoke left over through Blanchimont. Yassine Bebert of JCL Sim Racing number 2, the MMA MP4, broke loose midway through Blanchimont. Spun, didn't hit anything. But, looks like they towed back to pit lane.
Didn't hit anything, yet towed back to pit lane. Okay. We'll note to Virgil Racing. Currently back up to the fourth position on their roof. Just ahead of them, only about 12 seconds up the road actually. 12 seconds down the road is NX Racing Blue. 12 seconds up the road is Core Motorsports. Nils Kolk at the wheel. So, much like I mentioned before, which if you guys currently watching have actually been watching for that long, Core Motorsports, just quiet run. I believe they're third in points actually going into this race behind NX Racing Red and Team Redline. So currently their efforts would move them into second place in points. Been doing a very good job so far. Oh, seeing something happening. However, or did something happen and I somehow missed it?
What are you suspecting happened but didn't?
For some reason. I'm probably correct, I just lost track. Nope, I was looking at the wrong thing. I clicked on the wrong number. Pure Racing Team cars. The number 9 and the number 7. You can see up ahead is R4R Motorsport. Pure Racing Team 1 just came out of the pit, so they have fresh tires compared to R4R Motorsport 10 laps in. Gonna do another one of our onboards. We haven't done onboard in a few minutes.
We'll let you get this full lap. No talking.
Okay, thank goodness. Just want to note that the car you saw off to the right side, not now, but the car you saw at Blanchimont was JCL Simracing 2. You see, so slowly but surely, Pure Racing Team 1 catching R4R Motorsport.
Ten lap pit stop difference. R4R Motorsports, Scott Michaels, last pit lap 13. Pure Racing Team, Tom Valentini, last pit stop lap 3. Well, 3 laps ago, even.
I was gonna say, you made it all the way from lap 3.
Yeah, the lap 3. Yeah, that's... Must be powered by the air.
We also have All-Star Racing Team, as we're on board with right now, trying to hunt down the Flux Racing Team just ahead. Even though we just saw Flux Racing Team get that slowdown penalty. So we'll just flip back here. Pure Racing Team should be chasing down R4R, I would imagine. 10 lap fresher tires here. As for those wondering why it's a little silent, I'm letting you guys enjoy an onboard. I'm enjoying a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and watching some Supercross. So, you know, giving everyone a little break here.
Just saw on Twitter, Dream Factory tweeted a minute ago, kicked from the server, no internet drop by our driver. Incredible. During our best moments of the night, no words. Raul Diego is in the car now. They're in 31st. Not sure how much total time that connection drop cost him.
Yeah, it's... and my old ISP. It actually happened in iRacing as well. I remember the first Pro Series I was in. I kept timing out from races. But the ISP, for some reason, would cut out. Actually, I ended up having to get like a bandwidth monitor to figure it out what was going on. It would cut out for just like a second or two. Not even much. Maybe not even that. And it would just cut like the upload. So the download was still there. So I could still see cars around me. But I wasn't... having upload to the server, and then what would happen is, you know, I would get cut out of the server. Possibly same situation there, I have no idea. Internet's a funny thing, it's always a different situation, but that's just one possibility. I think of all of 2009, I probably dropped out of like 6 to 10 races minimum. Finally now, Pure Racing Team 1's right on the back of R4R Motorsport. Should be making a move here shortly. Most drivers and teams just taking their time now. Even if they're tired, they just want to take their time, make sure they don't make any mistakes.
Just looking through the MOE teams list on Twitter. Team Kimura said, a couple minutes ago, it's 3 a.m. 11 hours down, 13 to go. 53 car running, their 53 car running 37, slightly damaged, and 54 running in 7th, and currently the top McLaren.
Wow, that is true. Ever since Team Redline, actually now retired, I believe. And unfortunately, they haven't even reached the 70% mark, therefore they're not even going to get points for this round. That's a huge blow to them in the championship.
Yeah, they... Maybe play that for a while. In IRC, we were talking about it. Someone said that Enzo parked a car on Eau Rouge, went for pizza, and never came back.
Could think of a couple people that would say something like that.
Yeah.
Oh. Almost a little bit too cautious here. Kind of confusing both of them. Probably one of those situations where you should just commit and overtake the person. Oh, I believe...
That's going to be a slowdown.
Yeah, Scott Michaels most likely just got a slowdown there. If not, I'll be extremely surprised. He isn't slowing down, actually. Oh, and Tom's going to go for it. Wow.
You got it.
Yeah, so I just mentioned about committing to a pass, and he definitely did there.
He heard you and decided to prove you wrong, I guess.
Yeah. I wish they would do that when I tell them to do the gridding properly. To run through the positions real quick. Currently, NX Racing Red in the lead over Coanda Simsport in second, Core Motorsports third, Virgil Racing fourth, NX Racing Blue in fifth, and Glacier Racing sixth. And you have Team Camaro 2, Radicals Online 2, Team Iberica Racing Team. Wow, Iberica Racing Team in ninth. 10th is Pure Racing Team 2, 4th is R4R, and 12th is Pure Racing Team 1. 13th is Vortex Sim Racing. 14th is Mad Cow Racing 2. 15th is Race More Kraut Racing. And some other notables mentioned New World Simsport Scarlet, currently in 20th. KRT Motorsport 2, we had an interview with them, currently 23rd. Team TTL in 26th, they just had a little issue. They were 21st, now they're in 26th. I believe Dylan Sharman's now in the car. Yeah, they actually moved up to the 25th position. They have Dream Factory, they're now 31st. We just heard a Twitter message from them. Hammond Durant's team, they are decent. First two rounds of the season, they're currently 41st. Just talked about the Team Camaro number one car in 37th. Back here we have, actually, is this the start of, yes, there's start 46, 47, and 48th, start of the cars that have retired from the race. All these cars here are retired, including number 26, Team Redline. it's the current rundown of the field. You can see here that separation between the top two cars, both BMWs, about a minute 25 seconds.
So, Phil.
Yes.
On the whole, this round, you know, for time's sake, you did the lone qualifier system with target times. Did that work well enough, or you think you might do that for the remaining two rounds?
Oh, actually, no, now. I thought it would have been a simple thing that people would have been able to do. Some teams seem to not pay attention and don't even really know what they did wrong. And a simple fact of the matter is, if you have a 6 minute target time, you should not be doing a 2 minute 29 second lap time. So I don't know, to be honest. I'll have to think about it, and we'll probably send out a message to team managers asking them which one they would rather have. Simple fact of the matter is, if you do that, then you're starting from the pits no matter what. So to be honest, it's just unacceptable. It really is. We gave a 5 second, you know, span for target times, and you just have to simply hit it. Shouldn't be that difficult. It really shouldn't. Select few teams just had a little brain fade.
Yeah, there were a couple posts about that in the forum after. I think there was a little bit of pleading of ignorance when it was sent out in messages to the teams and discussed in multiple places.
Yeah, to be honest, it's just the responsibility of the team managers and the team members to know, you know, how the event works. Yes, this was new for this this round, simply because we were short on time. It's a 24-hour race. Only 25 hours is the maximum session time you can have in iRacing. So we needed people to be able to get into the session, which is what the 20-minute practice was for. And then once in the session, they needed to we needed a 30-minute qualifying. That 30-minute qualifying was literally just set the grid, and the best way to do that is just have people hit a target time. Maybe now that people understand that, maybe we'll go ahead and do it in future rounds. We'll see. Like I said, we just need to talk to the team managers, talk to the teams, and see what they think. Most importantly, we need to have teams realize what they're doing when they're registering for sessions. Because we had an incident today, and now Velocidaddy endurance team, unfortunately, are not able to race because someone decided to apply two teams to the server. We have no control on being able to remove one of them.
And I think it's fair to say that if iRacing would do things, I think we could argue, in a better way, none of these things would be an issue. If admins could remove a bogus team from the session and free up a slot.
Well, yeah, but at the same time,
could program a grid.
I agree with that. And that's, while that is true, and it's 100% true, it should be easier. However, it's one of those situations where you can't just say, you know, it's iRacing can make this a lot simpler. Because it could. It could. No doubt about it. However, you have to also say, you know, hey, team, you got to understand that you can't do something like that. That's silly. And don't play dumb about it. We already know it's dumb that you did it. Just, you know, be more considerate, understand what you're doing, be more responsible, and understand what your team members are doing. If you go and sign up two teams at the same time, that means that you guys aren't communicating with each other, and that's just unorganized, and that's irresponsible. You shouldn't be doing that.
It's
about as simple as it is.
Obviously, you work within the construct of the system, and if the system has limitations, you have to deal with it. And since it is kind of strange, as a team, you have to pay attention. It's the job of the team manager. It's impossible for race organizers of any series, whether it's in iRacing, R factors and, of course, real life, it's hard to just hit every single driver individually. You can't pull every driver aside or send them a message telling what to do. The way the organizers have to do is they send it to the team managers, and it's the team manager's job to send it to their team and make sure their team understands it. And if someone on their team doesn't understand it and they can't explain it, they talk to the admins and say, hey, we have a guy that doesn't quite understand what you mean. Whether it's just a translation issue or just maybe not quite understanding the wording, that's why there's communication channels, so the admins and drivers can be on the same page.
Yep, pretty much. We actually had a team manager PM us a simple question before the race started, and we were able to, you know, answer it in a timely fashion, and then, you know, everything was good. It's just some people, I don't know, they just go in blindly and hope that they can just magically figure it out. But when you do that, you risk screwing over somebody else, which turns out is what happened today.
And unfortunately, you did find the issue of the duplicate car quite late. And you could have technically passed to restart the session, but
yeah,
that would have just delayed an already long race, and that's not something you want to do.
Yeah, plus I don't want something like that to happen again then, because you try to shorten the practice that people are allowed to, that people are able to join, and that could end up with multiple teams joining as well, and it just goes, I don't want to turn it into a freak show by any means.
I think, like round one where iRacing, that would have been a fair case to restart the session. Especially
yeah,
since it was a 6-hour race, you had plenty of time to move with.
Yeah, that was a legitimate issue as well. You could see it. Like, they signed up and you could actually see where they signed up in BMW and whatnot, and they had a picture of their car. But then for some reason they joined the server and it's a McLaren with a completely different number. That's a legitimate reason. You know, and we didn't restart the server simply because we didn't know if we did that other teams would end up getting that issue, because we actually had that happen then in round two in qualifying. Team Redline had that happen in qualifying three for Suzuka for Q3. Enzo Benito joined the session, and for some reason he was in the BMW instead of the McLaren. Completely different number and everything. So far that hasn't happened since the newest build. Hopefully that doesn't happen again. Yeah, they're just freak accidents, really.
Yep, and of course today's issue will cause the admins to have to decide what's the make good, if any, for Velocidaddy for being locked out due to another team's mistake.
Yeah, I believe they were actually locked in going into this race, so who knows, we might do a special case to where they're locked into the next race or something like that. If they were locked in,
into this race, they were 15th on 84 points.
Oh, that's terrible. 15th in points, yeah.
30th had 59 points. Of course, still with 12 and a half hours to go, still room for several cars to retire, and, you know, anything can happen. There's obviously consideration that can be made if there is a special, you know, just lock them in anyway, even if they're outside of the top 30, just to make sure they get a chance to race or anything of the sort. And of course the admins will have to decide what action to take against the team that caused the issue.
Got a little request to see the 78 car. I prefer not to look at the back of it.
Well, sometimes it can't be avoided.
Yes, I know. It's just a joke. There, as you can see, the car is pretty heavily damaged.
Yeah, that rear wing is kind of bent the wrong way. The Hammond Endurance team with the Hispano-American or Hispano-America team. We've got Luis Rodriguez in the car right now. Christian Croce having done 9 laps so far. Martin Solari doing 52. Guillaume F. Atunes-Sarat from Iberia done 80. And Sergio Girelli doing 52. A couple of those names familiar from the MOE LFS days.
That's Sergio Girelli. Did he actually race in MOE, or did I just remember?
I think he
speed.
Did in the. I think he did in the 2012 one.
No, possibly.
There's always an Argentine team.
That's true. LFS LA.
Yep.
Oh, I have a situation here. Sorry to flip, but NX Racing Blue just came out of the pits, and we will have Radicals on line two just ahead of them. Simon Cattell, I believe, is fresh in that car. I would say that for a fact, but I forgot who he'd be switching with. I believe maybe Robin Chris-Cups. Was just in the car previously. Akoyanda Simsport also used to be them just behind.
Yep, they just
made a pit stop. Now Marcus Linderman's in the car, first time in the race. So maybe he's the person who's helping out in the night.
NX Racing Red coming up to complete their 26th lap since stop. Coming out of Blanchemont now. Next red passing along, so it'll be at least a 2-lap gap between the pit stops, but after the last sequence of stops, remember, Coanda had it down to 3 laps.
Yep.
And it'll be interesting to see if Coanda can whittle that down even more. Still 12 and a half hours remaining in the 24 hours.
I'd be curious to see, actually, when they do get on the same level, if then they'll stop fuel saving and just push and try to catch up that way, or if they're going to keep doing it and possibly cut a pit stop. That's going to be the interesting one there.
And even if they just get to a point where maybe they'll have a short last fill, that way they can have fresher tires at the later stage of the race?
I don't know if that's actually worth it, since the pit lane's so long. As we see Simon Cattell for NX Racing Blue passing Yari Whittle. I hope I said that correctly. Around the outside there, final corner, or final chicane. Actually haven't seen Marcus Linderman drive here today, so let's just go on board with him here. This will be his first fast lap out of the pits, I believe. Same with Simon Cattell just ahead. Thank you. Not a bad first lap there. Actually, NX Racing Red currently in the pits. Jake Sturgis just stopped. PJ Sturgis getting in.
By the way, the first 9 hours of the race are available for you to vision on YouTube. Part 3 just finished processing its first level. It'll be still processing the higher qualities as we speak. I see on the stream that we've still got about 382 of you with us. For every single one of you that is sticking with us, no matter where in the world you are, we thank you for joining us. If you're thinking of heading off for a nap for a few hours, that's fine. We'll be back. We'll still be here when you wake back up. Race continues until just after 16 hours UTC on Sunday the 11th of January. We'll be there through the finish, plus a 10 or 15 minute post-race wrap-up with interviews with the top three teams. Anyone else we can get our hands on post-race?
Something's wrong here with the 74 car. Not quite sure what's going on.
That's Flux Racing Team.
They might have gotten us. This is something that happens. If you get a slowdown in Eau Rouge and you don't serve it before the first sector is
over,
you get stuck.
Yeah, because doesn't the first timing sector end right before Lake Holmes? I think they did because they went through Eau Rouge and literally right after they crested Redion, they were just crawling at 130 miles an hour down Kemmel Strait.
This is really weird here. Oh, and they just caused an accident with the Camaro 2 car, and that's going to give them a penalty, that's for sure. Can't be cruising in the middle of the track like that for no reason.
Oh yeah, they kind of, I think they may have realized too late that the other guy was coming. They were kind of in the middle of the track, kind of jinked to the left, and Patel had committed to going left where there was room, and then a little bit of non-committalism.
Yeah, that's a bad situation there. Flux Racing Team most likely just gave themselves a penalty, even though they're probably in the pits. Actually, you know what? It sounds like he's out of fuel. That's what it actually is. You can hear it. He's out of fuel right now.
Maybe.
If he has to get around this bend, he's in trouble. He needs to do a tow.
I Well, they started 41st, so I would guess they're on the early part of pit lane.
Well, the thing is that if a car is coming up behind them right now, they need to do a tow, simple as that.
There was one car, but it's already stopped.
They just sent a tow, fuel gone. Okay.
Yep, they just sent a message. And it is sputtering, slowing, and it's ground to a halt in the pit lane in Hairpin, and they've just called for tow. Oh, I wasn't replay by a little bit.
Currently now showing Crax Racing, just behind team, I know that guy's name, but I can't pronounce it. Known that guy's name for years, actually.
Oh, in car 66?
Yes. Well, no, not the actual driver's name, but the team name itself.
Team Huizingeveld?
Yes.
For the record, in about 20-25 minutes, we are going to do another one of our pauses in the stream action to break the recording to manageable chunks that we can upload to varying places.
Let's know the our YouTube page.
We do like to thank Simrace.TV and its headman Lutzanger for all he does for us. Not just this season with Emily, but for other events that we have done. Most notably things with New Dimension Racing, the group that, one, owns this TeamSpeak that we use, and two, organized a bunch of events in Live for Speed, which kind of filled the void left when MOE stopped down for a little bit. He's been a big help for a lot of other broadcasters through other sims. Tomorrow seems to be a German R-Factor day. I do know there is a German, the R-Factor Motorsport Liga is racing here at Spa-Francorchamps a little after we're finished tomorrow. You can watch that at Simrace.TV. That race is the, is the IRML GT3 Cup 2014-2015, round 4 from Spa. Using the cars we're using. And that broadcast will start sometime an hour or two after ours.
Oh, this is very, very bad news for Virgil Racing. Looks like Anders Dahl has possibly just dropped from the server.
Yes, he has,
and he's connecting now. Also to note, Team Kamara 2 haven't left the pitch just yet. Looks like they need a damage repair. Simon Trindell currently ready to jump in that car and drive off. They were in the 7th position, currently dropping back. Now they're finally taking off 9th position.
Anders Dahl disconnected from just out of Stavelo.
Oh, that's big. That's lost a lot of time then.
It is nice though, in iRacing, I can just quickly hit rewind and see what happened, unlike making the LFS Emily days when we wondered where someone dropped from. We just had to kind of infer it based on what the tracker said, or you had to open up another instance of LFS to look at the replay.
True.
Small victories.
See no gain here. However, we do see, well, due to the unfortunate events from Virgil Racing, we see the great lonely 4GT. Currently in the fourth position, Alexei Lomo behind the wheel. It's kind of cruising. Actually, kind of really alone right now. 30 seconds up is Core Motorsports. And then over a minute, about a minute and 24 seconds back to Simon Cattell and NX Racing Blue. Top of the field's actually kind of spread out quite a bit. Everything outside of the top five is actually really close. The top half is split up quite a bit. You see Anders Dahl back in the car now. Currently saying that he's in the 8th position. If so, he is extremely lucky. I think he only lost a lap by the looks of it. Probably by the time he got back into the server, just got done towing his car.
Are for our motorcycle.
Yep.
Yep. They are fresh off the pit stop. 2 laps since. The team they're chasing All-Star Racing, which they're now alongside with. 22 laps since their last pit stop, so that's fresh boots going around old boots. One thing I like seeing about in the week or weeks leading up to a race, all the people hosting 3, 4, 5, 6 hour practice sessions.
Yeah, thank you to literally every single person who does that. I know that we don't host, we maybe host 1 or 2 around, but outside of that, we don't host that many. So thank you to the people who host. There's 30 or 40 sessions probably in between each round, so thank you to all the people who do that.
And with the session charges, that is kind of a pretty penny going iRacing's way.
Yeah, that is true.
Of course, in the middle of 2015 Season 1 for the iRacing official races, you racing in any particular series this season, Phil?
Not this season. However, after MOE ends, and I'm not so busy with it, then yeah, I might actually get into some racing again. I've been watching so much racing that I need to get into it. But I think maybe when... Oh, mistake there by Pure Racing Team 2, and that just messed up Virgil Racing pretty badly there. Sorry about that. But yeah, I think hopefully Real Racing doesn't start up and then I get chucked into that as well. Hopefully I can get a few races and maybe just jump into stuff every now and then. That's actually what I've been doing lately, just jumping into random races and having some fun at night. Otherwise, work and massive endurance is pretty much all I've been doing. Practically 2 jobs, actually. Just one doesn't pay what the other does.
This one, in fact, is a money losing venture.
This one was what, sorry?
This one is a money losing venture.
Yeah.
Well, Anders Dahl lagging again.
Oh, this is not good at all.
Going. Back.
Oh, he's back. Yeah, for now. We gotta watch out there to see what's going on. As we see Core Motorsports car entering the pits. By entering the pits, I mean entering their pit stall in general. Sooner or later, as they drive through everybody else's pit stall. All those poor crew members getting hit. Doing a driver change. We now see the Glacier Racing car up to third position. One thing about this is, thankfully, Supercross is currently on the West Coast. Get some Supercross racing in until probably midnight or so. So that'll keep us awake. However, after that, bad news, there's no real sports or racing going on at 12 to 6 a.m. in the morning.
Yeah, but the only thing in America between midnight and 6 a.m., especially on the cable, is just infomercials.
Yeah, there's not much to watch. I can pop on a couple movies, but that ain't gonna help anything because I'm not gonna pay attention to them. Actually, I remember a 2009 race, Masters of Endurance 24-hour race. I was doing an in-car interview probably this time of night. Actually, about another 2 hours from now. Yeah, this is too early to have one. It was about midnight, between midnight and 3 a.m. my time. I was in the middle of a triple stint. Had an in-car interview. I remember having it was a shootout at Arundel, late models. I was watching that during the while racing.
By the way, for anyone who might be interested in the National Football League's divisional playoffs, this weekend.
Don't you spoil it. Do it.
It's the
fourth. You were going to spoil it, weren't you?
No. The game between Baltimore and New England ended with a winner. And the Seattle Seahawks and Carolina Panthers game was in the fourth quarter with 12 minutes 53 seconds remaining. And there's a touchdown gap in that game.
And that's all we're going to tell you.
Oh, I spy with my little eye in TeamSpeak a Swede.
This is a surprise. Surprise visit.
A surprise visit?
You're going to stay with us for a few hours, right?
No. I got to drive soon, so I'm just being quickly.
Oh. NX Racing blue car, correct?
Yes, sir.
Timo Ivonen, legendary member of NX Racing. So you're currently on position 5. Simon Cattell is currently in there. Is he complaining about anything?
Well, I kind of joined, but just woke up pretty recently, so I don't know. I don't think so. I think he's been pretty quiet today.
That'll be a miracle in and of itself.
Nah, when he gets in these races, Simon's a weird person. He gets in that zone, and that's when he goes full Prost mode, and you don't hear him speak. You just know that he's driving, and he's... It's very, very clear cut on that.
One word answers.
He's not finished, but I mean, he's very quiet and just gets the job done, lets you know when he's about to pit, and that's about it.
Yeah, Simon's been really solid today, so doing really good. How are you guys doing? You guys got a tire or not?
No, not yet.
Yeah, I got a little bit of food in me, and outside of that, I don't know. I've downed way too much water, so I might have to go to the bathroom soon. Other than that, just trying to follow along stuff on TV and stuff. Oh, not even to halfway yet, so there's no way I can be tired right now.
The tiredness starts at about 3 or 4 a.m. when you can start to see the light at the end of the tunnel of the European commentators coming back, so we Americans don't have to talk anymore. But it's just so far away that it's like... sorts of bleh.
What's it like waking up at before 5 a.m.?
It's not too bad. I mean, I'm used to it from Oval Pro, so it's almost the same time I normally get up for those races, so it's not too bad.
Races start at 3 a.m. that time, right?
Yeah, about a couple of hours. Doesn't really matter. Can't feel the difference.
How is that waking up for pro and then going to work right after?
Horrible.
Are you going to be able to do it for DWC if you make it in DWC?
Yeah, there's only it's 2 days a month.
I guess if you look at it that way, that's true.
Yeah, I mean, we do this sim thing so much anyway, so I mean...
That's true. This is... I wouldn't even say my break right now. I think I've worked more during this Masters of Endurance season than I have in sim racing prior.
Has there been a lot of protests and stuff for you to do? I watched the parts of the race, but I haven't.
I'll count how many protests there were in the race. Not very many.
There hasn't been one for a while, actually. Most of the stuff has just been cars going off on their own and whatnot. Have seen that a lot with the roofs. I guess just the rear tires, aggressive setups, and whatnot. And they end up, you know, pretty much spinning off all on their own. Then also the McLaren, a lot of issues with that. I don't know if you're awake for the Team Redline mishap.
No, I was, but I heard about it. Yeah,
yeah, just I think just the BMW is one of those cars to where, you know, it's just consistent, and you don't have to really worry about it, you know, killing you at any point in time if you make, you know, a decent setup for it. Same thing, really. You can almost say the same thing with McLaren and roof, but I think in those two cars, you have to be so conservative that it kind of hinders it compared to the BMW.
Yeah, I guess everyone goes to pretty extreme. Goes pretty extreme on the setups to find more speed, so that also makes it a lot harder to drive it on the limit all the time, especially for 24 hours.
Yeah, and I think actually that's where Glacier Racing kind of went completely opposite. They're in a car that has immense amount of top speed, yet they're running almost full wing, rear wing. So, and they're able to utilize the cornering. But yeah, most of our things that we've had to watch has been the off tracks. The 10 car now has had two penalties for it. A lot of other teams just on their warnings. I don't think the NX Racing red car hasn't had a strike yet, so they've been doing a really good job. So it's just simply, I don't think Coand has had them either. And the funny thing is those are the two cars at the top of the list right now. So.
Well, I guess it's a bit easier to hold back when you're in a comfortable position.
That's true. But I think you get into that comfortable position by staying calm from the beginning. Maybe this is getting too mentally into it. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised. Well, not really surprised, but yeah, they're just doing a really good job with that 4GT.
Yeah, we have hourly updates. We gotten an interview pretty much once every 3 hours, I think, from those guys. So, yeah, they're sure to give us updates on the car. It's actually the first update from NX guys.
Yeah, I kind of thought that, so that's why I decided to just surprise you guys.
Yeah, I haven't spoke to any of them. Let them kind of just do their own thing. There's plenty of other people, other teams in this team speak, but prefer not to ask them any questions or anything like that. Just let them focus on their own race. If they want to do an interview, they can come to us. Speaking about Glacier Racing, they're currently in the pits, doing their pit stop.
By the way, Timu, we did mention it a little bit ago, but next week will be the 1 year since Tomek Nogiek passed on. Since you raced against him in LFS and MOA, I wondered if you had any thoughts about him.
It's already been a year.
On the 14th of January.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah, I mean, obviously everyone misses him. He was a great guy, super fast on track, really talented, so... Such a shame that it happened, and the way it happened, but I guess that's life. But I think almost everyone remembers all the good things about him. So his spirit will always be with us on track, so...
I do remember your teammate Isaac Price had some very good scraps with him in during GT series.
Yeah, him and Isaac were like such big competitors against each other that they sometimes seemed like they were arch enemies, but in fact they were like one of the best friends in LFS. So
yeah, looking at them from the outside, you'd think they hate each other. It wasn't like that at all.
Nah, it's just the rivalry was really big, but they still had a lot of respect for each other. So.
I think one thing that it did show was how much we in the sim racing community really actually do connect with each other on not just the competitive level, but a personal level.
Yeah, I mean, we spent so much time on the sim and around the sim and with our teammates and competitors and everything else, so obviously grow into it, become a bit of a family without even noticing it.
Yeah, hit the sim race community hard when we found out the news, but definitely competitive spirit lives on.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Approaching the 12-hour mark here.
Yeah, 5 minutes from it.
Oh, it's already been 12 hours.
Already? You act like it's been fast.
Yeah, it's been fast.
Oh, I wish I could say the same. This 12 hours is way longer than the first round. Actually, I don't know. The first round was pretty painful. Started waking up at 5 a.m. But...
Good.
I'm still trying to decide if I want to go to sleep or not after this race is over. My body will want to, but I don't know if I will want to because I got to work Monday morning, so... I don't know how that's going to work. Taking a quick nap probably isn't going to work.
Yeah. I think last year after the GT World Series 24-hour race in Liver Speed that I admitted you helped with the broadcast with Phil. I think basically after I uploaded the replays and started the stream uploading, I went to bed at like 3 o'clock that afternoon. 2:30 the next morning when I had to go to work.
Oof. Wait, you said 2:30 the next morning?
Yeah, when I had
to
wake up here. Basically, almost 2 hours of sleep.
Yeah, the problem is this race ends at 11 a.m. And if I go to sleep, let's say at 12, if I'm even that lucky to go to sleep by 12, then I'm going to sleep until 10 p.m. and then be up 6 hours or something like that until I go to work overnight. I don't know if I can do that.
Oh, and we just had an incident at the top of, or at Redion, about a minute or two ago, involving the car 129, the GTRS Azure car.
Oh,
losing it up, losing it at Redion and connecting with the left-hand side wall. Team Evening has left us.
Yeah, he's actually about to be driving soon.
Yep. Well, since it is just shy of halftime, I think now's a good chance to hit a pause on the stream.
Yeah, so we can get back going, get on air right before halftime.
Yes, sir. So, your stream should reconnect in a few moments. We will see you on the flip side here for the 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing.